Good evening, everyone, and thank you so much for your patience. My name is Ambassador Ruben Brigitte. I'm Dean of the Elliott School of International Affairs. I'm very pleased to welcome back to campus one of our very distinguished alumni, Senator Tammy Duckworth of Illinois. Senator Duckworth holds a master's degree from the Elliott School of International Affairs, the finest school of international affairs in the world. And she also holds an honorary doctorate degree from George Washington University, which she received in 2017 at our university commencement. Senator, please allow me to thank you for your many years of service to this country and for remaining an engaged member of the GW and Elliott School community.
Thank you.
Senator Duckworth is a trailblazer for veterans and women and an advocate for ethical leadership. We need that leadership more now than ever, especially on this day, which is Global Ethics Day. This year's theme is, quote, ethics in action. And I can't think of a better speaker who exemplifies global ethics in action more than Senator Duckworth. Here at the Elliott School, we have elevated these types of discussion with our Leadership, Ethics, and Practice, or LEAP initiative, which prepares Elliott School students for challenges related to leadership and the complex ethical and moral dilemmas they will encounter during their careers. One group that is taking these challenges to heart is our host this evening, the Delta Phi Epsilon Professional Foreign Service Sorority. Ladies, where are you? There we go, Delta Phi, there you go. This student group took the initiative to invite Senator Duckworth, making this a prime example of how our students not only gain exposure to key players in government, but actually develop and host the programming themselves. This is something truly special about our student body here at the Elliott School and at GW, and we are very proud of what they achieve while they are here. So on that note, I would like to welcome Delta Phi Epsilon's president, Elliott School senior Maggie Myman, to the stage to formally introduce our speaker and moderator. So ladies and gentlemen, please enjoy the discussion. Maggie, floor is yours.
Good evening, and thank you, Dean Brigitte, for that warm welcome, and thank you all for your patience this evening. My name is Maggie Myman, and I am this year's president of Delta Phi Epsilon Professional Foreign Service Sorority. I'd like to extend a special thank you to the Elliott School Alumni Programs Office and to the LEAP Initiative for help making tonight's events possible. It's testament to the type of the support that the Elliott School provides its students and its student organizations, and we wouldn't have the same education without it. Delta Phi Epsilon is a pre-professional organization that seeks to promote the leadership of women in international affairs fields by providing professional development and mentorship opportunities. We strive for internationally focused education that facilitates growth and encourages women to pursue careers in global service. Tonight, we're honored to host Senator Tammy Duckworth, who we feel exemplifies DPE's values of leadership, service, and female empowerment. Senator Duckworth is an Iraq War veteran, a Purple Heart recipient, and a former Assistant Secretary of the Department of Veterans Affairs. She was among the first Army women to fly combat missions during Operation Iraqi Freedom, and Duckworth served in the reserve forces for 23 years before retiring from military service in 2014 at the rank of lieutenant colonel. She was elected to the U.S. Senate in 2016 after representing Illinois' 8th Congressional District in the U.S. House of Representatives for two terms. In the U.S. Senate, Duckworth serves on several influential committees, including the Armed Services Committee, the Environment and Public Works Committee, the Commerce, Science, and Transportation Committee, and the Small Business and Entrepreneurship Committee. As Dean Brigitte mentioned, Senator Duckworth received her master's degree from the Elliott School in 1992 and an honorary degree from the university in 2017. In 2018, after Senator Duckworth became the first senator to give birth while serving in office, she sent a message to working mothers across the country about the value of family-friendly policies after securing a historic rules change that allowed senators to bring their infant children to the floor, yet another example of the senator's commitment to ethical leadership. Tonight's event will be moderated by Ms. Carly Nuttall, who is currently a law clerk with the Montgomery County District Court and has a long history of serving in public service, working, among other places, in the DC U.S. Attorney's Office, the Montgomery County State Attorney's Office, the Transportation Security Administration, the U.S. Department of Justice, the United States Senate, and the Massachusetts State Senate. Carly graduated magna cum laude from the George Washington University in 2013 and graduated cum laude from American University Washington College of Law in 2019. In 2013, Carly was the president of the vice president of Delta Phi Epsilon Professional Foreign
That's
Service Sorority.
President.
Without further ado, please join me in welcoming Senator Duckworth for tonight's event.
All right, let's get started. I'm assuming the mics are working? Yes? Okay, we had some battery issues before, so just checking.
Yes.
Senator Duckworth, you are obviously a prominent leader in national security, but you also have a responsibility to your constituents who are more likely to be worried on a day-to-day basis about kitchen table issues. So how do you balance the pressures and the competing priorities between domestic and international political issues?
Well, I will tell you, when I travel the state of Illinois, especially even recently within the last couple of weeks, the questions I get asked in town halls and the like are about kitchen table issues. Healthcare being always one of the top three, if not number one. Right now, our farmers are really suffering, so I am dealing a lot with ag policy. But what I say to my constituents is that this is all about national strength, and I try to redefine national strength beyond just tanks and guns and helicopters and how big a defense budget we have. And so what I say to my constituents is, like, you know, if you believe in a strong national, a strong nation, and we lead the free world, we also have to be able to feed ourselves. We also have to be able to generate our own power. We also have to be able to safeguard our water and educate our kids and make sure that they're the next generation and try to put it together in that way. And that message does get across. But I will tell you that on a day-to-day basis, when I talk to my constituents, they're not concerned about most international issues. They're concerned about the fact that they're about to lose their family farm because of the trade wars with China.
Understandably so. So what does military readiness look like today, and what should we be doing to make sure that our technologies are as advanced and as capable as possible?
Well, so first off, we have to make sure that we understand the definition of military readiness. It's not just how much equipment we own and the status of that equipment. Yes, we have an issue with military readiness when it comes to our military fighter jets, for example. They're not all flying. Some of the types of jets we have, F-16s and like, are at a readiness level of 50%, which means that 50% of the fleet is able to fly right now, as opposed to 100% or 80%. There is that component of it. But readiness is also personnel. That's actually the most critical part of military readiness. And we have an issue right now with the personnel readiness for our military. The Pentagon has for the last several years now put out a study that says that of the entire population of young people in this country, age 18 to 24, who are eligible for military service, they can only recruit from 29% of that population. 71% of the population of young people in this country, age 18 to 24, do not qualify for military service for one of a handful of reasons. One, they either don't have a GED high school diploma, or even if they do, they can't pass the military's math and English test that is written at the eighth grade level. Two, they have some sort of an untreated health condition, usually childhood asthma, that due to lack of access to good health care. Or dental, because lack of access to dentists. In fact, my own unit, when we were activated to deploy to Iraq, 80% of my non-deployable soldiers were non-deployable because of dental issues. We had one person had to have 8 teeth pulled. The third is some sort of felony conviction, usually tied to either the opioid epidemic or, more often, to marijuana possession, even in states where marijuana is now legal. And those three things knock out 71% of the eligible population. So what's the point of having F-35 fighter jets and most advanced weaponry out there if we actually can't find the people to fly them or fix them?
Yeah, that's a great point. On to our next question. Can you comment on the increasing levels of hyper-partisanship that we've been seeing recently and how that affects our ability to command respect and power on the global stage?
Well,
it's a late question.
I'm late tonight, and I want to thank everyone for waiting on me. I'm late tonight because we had votes, but the reason that our votes went late was because there was a little meeting that happened at the White House today. You may have been reading about it online, and maybe some of the feed coming out of the president, from the president himself. I think at that meeting, you know, I mean, the president's been calling Speaker Pelosi unhinged and nervous Nancy and all of these. This is not acceptable. This is not acceptable behavior. And in fact, it has diminished us in the eyes of the world. And what the president has done with leaving our Kurdish allies to be slaughtered has diminished us in the eyes of the world. And we need to come together. That said, I've been able to pass legislation in a bipartisan way with some of my colleagues. They've been low level. They're important legislation, but they've not been the big piece of legislation that you hear about. Nobody covers that. On the other hand, I wish more of my colleagues would step forward and really condemn the president for the rhetoric that he uses that really does not unite us as a nation.
And actually, what you just said about President Trump's actions in withdrawing the troops from Syria is a great pivot to the next question. So President Trump recently announced the withdrawal of U.S. troops from Syria, and you have obviously been an outspoken critic of that decision. What, in your opinion, are the likely national and international security ramifications of that withdrawal?
Sure. So in the last 10 days, a little over a week, the president, based on this decision that he came to while on the phone with the president of Turkey, what has he done in these last 10 days as a result of this decision to withdraw U.S. troops and to tell Turkey, go ahead and invade Syria? Well, number one, he has basically abandoned our Kurdish allies to be slaughtered. And we're talking about a force of people who have fought alongside U.S. troops, shoulder to shoulder with us, who have been the main people on the front lines in the fight against ISIS. He has allowed now the opportunity for those ISIS fighters who had been captured to escape because the Kurds were the ones who were guarding those prison camps. And hundreds, if not thousands, have and will continue to escape. And they will flow not just throughout Syria, but into Iraq as well. For example, in Iraq, there's a camp there that has 30,000 ISIS wives and children. So some of those fighters are going to try to find their way to those camps. He has diminished us in the eyes of the world, and made America less safe by allowing ISIS fighters to escape. He has put us in a position where a NATO ally, Turkey, has now fired artillery against U.S. forces. That happened just about 20 hours ago, and we actually, 20 hours ago, launched fighter jets and AH-64 attack helicopters in a show of force against a NATO ally. He has now allowed Russia to move into the space that America used to be, and now the Russians are actively patrolling that area. His actions now will have opened a land bridge between Iran going into Syria that will be a direct pipeline for attacks against Israel, a nation that he claims he wants to defend and support, and yet he's now allowed Iran a chance at that land bridge. And it just keeps on going. So this decision by this one person, by the commander-in-chief, obviously with no military training, without listening to his military leaders, in just the last 10 days, has not made America safer, right? It's not made us great again. It's not made us a world leader. It has diminished us in the eyes of the world. It has destroyed our information gathering capabilities, because where is our human intelligence going to come from now? No one's going to work with us because they know we will abandon you to be slaughtered like we have the Kurds. This is just the first 10 days. We can only imagine what will happen in the subsequent weeks and months to come.
Absolutely. So perhaps in a counterpoint here, I have a question about ethical leadership. And I think you just gave a great example of not so ethical leadership, perhaps.
Well, no, what he did was a lawful order. He's a commander-in-chief of the United States, and he made a lawful order. He didn't listen to his military commanders, but it was a lawful order. What's not ethical is if we find out that he made this decision because Erdogan promised him some sort of benefits for Trump Towers in Turkey. That would be unethical.
Right.
But what he made, that decision he made right now on the appearance's sake looks like just a really bad tactical decision.
Right. Fair enough. But on the topic of ethical leadership, could you talk about how that concept has been important throughout your career in the military and public service?
Yeah, it's the hallmark of professionalism for a military officer, is ethical leadership, is making sure that you live up to the codes that you swore by when you swore your oath of office as a military officer. And it's really, really astonishing to me to have a commander-in-chief who's willing to sell out his own military and our allies. And I am part of, just so that you know, for transparency's sake, I am part of the lawsuit, the emoluments lawsuit against the president right now for all of the profits the Trump hotels are making as a result of his decisions. And by the way, right around the same time the president made this decision to back away and allow Turkey to move into Syria, Ivanka Trump actually tweeted a thing thanking Turkey for the decision on the Trump Tower, the Trump Hotel in Ankara.
So much of what we seem to hear from Congress today is about short-term solutions to what are larger, more systemic problems, things like Social Security, Medicare, state or EPA budget authorizations. Why do you believe it's more important for us to be thinking about these things in the long term for both domestic and international issues? And then as a corollary to that, what in your opinion are those long-term issues that we really ought to be addressing?
Well, I mean, we have to address climate change. Number one, we have to address climate change. It is a real threat to the human species as a whole. It is a national security threat, as the effects of climate change are being used by groups like Boko Haram to take advantage of populations fleeing drought in order to spread their influence. It is going to force U.S. troops to go into areas and put us in conflict with countries like Russia as they're trying to exploit what will now be open sea lanes in the Arctic Circle that used to not be accessible before. It is about the security of our nation in terms of what's happening with our economy. We've had devastating flooding on the Mississippi. Most people don't realize Illinois is a Mississippi state. The entire western and southern border of Illinois is the Mississippi River, and we've had historic floods this year. And not historic, not in that they're how high the floods have gone, but this has never happened before in history, in that we had floods that usually when you have a flood on the Mississippi, it goes up, and then you hope it doesn't top the levees, and then it crests after about 48, 72 hours, maybe 96 hours, and then it goes down. We had a flood that crested, didn't top the levees, but stayed there for 139 days. This has never happened. This is an effect of climate change. So there are all of these issues that are intertwined that are not just domestic issues. If you care about flooding on the Mississippi and farmers losing their land, then you have to care about climate change. If you care about making sure you have a strong military, then you want to make investments in early childhood education and public school systems and healthcare, affordable healthcare for all Americans, because then you want more of those 18 to 24-year-olds to be recruitable, right? This is all intertwined, and we have to look at this in a systemic approach, and we can't just say, well, that's just transportation and domestic policy, and that's just energy policy, and that's just coal miners, and no, it's all intertwined. We live in a global world and a global economy and a global climate, and we can't be isolated anymore. If we want to lead the free world, then we have to step forward and lead the free world. We can't just say we're the greatest power, we have more F-35 fighter jets than anyone else, listen to us. No. We have to get out there more, actually, with our economic, our soft powers, with our diplomatic powers, than we should, actually, with our military in order to truly lead the world. Because no one's going to follow us if we just lead with our military.
Oh, great point. So speaking of issues like climate change, how do you find a way to work with colleagues in the Senate that you have that deny that climate change is even a problem? How do you find a way to work with those colleagues to achieve a solution?
So I talked to them. Most of my colleagues have now come to a point where they're no longer, the famous image of the Republican presidential contenders a few cycles ago raising their hands and saying they didn't believe in climate change. They're smart enough not to do that anymore. But they're not moving very fast on the issue. And what I try to find ways to talk to them to get the policy across that I want to get across. So one of the things I talk to them about is floods. I can reach out to my colleagues on flooding. Right now, it is likely that over 100 United States military bases will be flooded due to rising seawater due to climate change. So I talked to all of my southern state colleagues, you know, with those military bases. I'm like, if you want a strong military, you need to work on, we need to re-enter the Paris Accord, because if we don't do it and we don't make a change, all those military bases, which largely are in southern states, are going to be underwater. We still haven't fixed some of the issues that have come up as a result of the hurricanes that have occurred as a result of climate change in the southern states, or, you know, in North Carolina and all sorts of places. We still haven't even fixed our bases that have been damaged severely in Florida. This is only going to get worse. So I try to find a way to talk to them along those lines and say, well, can't you just support it based on this, on rising seawater? Or can't you do it based on, you know, can't you support biofuel? Let me give you an example. The Navy Secretary under President Obama, Ray Mabus, actually pushed very hard for the Navy to move towards completely biofuel. And he actually ran an entire Navy training exercise using all biofuel blends. Everything from generators to ships to aircraft used biofuel blends to demonstrate that it was fully, something was fully viable. And what I say to my Republican colleagues is, like, why are we not investing in better battery technology? I don't care if you believe in climate change or not, but you should believe in better battery technology. Yes, it will help with solar power, it will help with energy storage and all that, but by the way, the fewer batteries our troops have to carry means the more bullets they can carry. And try to speak to them in along those lines.
Right, so I kind of isolate the issue to something that they can absolutely get behind, even mm-hmm. if perhaps the broader topic isn't something that they're willing to sign on to.
But they have blocked the Navy's attempt to further invest in biofuel since Secretary Mabus. Every year it comes up in the NDAA and the defense budget, and every year it has been struck down.
Do you think that there will come a time when it will actually go through?
I think so. I think so. When we control the House and the Senate.
Yeah, we can applaud that. So you mentioned earlier the importance of national strength as not just military preparedness, but a more cohesive concept. So thinking in the long term, you touched upon this, but more specifically, what do you see as the most important ways to protect that national strength going forward and to enhance it?
I think we need to invest a lot more in our diplomatic efforts and all of the other forms of American influence. Look, I grew up in Southeast Asia in the late 70s and the early 80s. And it was interesting growing up in Southeast Asia during that time because, see, the United States had just lost a war. And yet, in Southeast Asia, as I was growing up, people loved the United States. They wanted to come to the U.S. They respected us. They wanted to send their kids to school here. They wanted to do business with the United States. And they held us up as a model because of our values. And why is that? It was because of the Peace Corps. It was because of the American diplomacy. It was because we were there standing up for what was right. Because if you wanted to do business, doing business with American companies was the way to go because our judiciary was independent. And you knew that if you got into a dispute, you could go to the American court system and have a fair hearing. And you knew, and American ambassadors, you know, when I was a kid, American ambassador was always out opening up a hospital or an educational program, or engaging all of those soft powers. And all of those American young people who were in the Peace Corps, who were all over the world, you know, that was where our influence came, our values and what we stood for and how we engaged with the world. It wasn't how big our military was, because in the 70s, we just lost a war to an army in black pajamas. We didn't have a great military. People didn't respect us because we just lost the Vietnam War. They respected us because of everything else we stood for. And we've moved away from that. And we now define American power as if it's only the military. And don't get me wrong, I love the military, and I love good military equipment. I mean, I'm all about tanks and guns and helicopters. More helicopters, the better. I think helicopters are sexy, you know? I do. Who doesn't? It's my twisted mind. But I will tell you that that is not the main source of our strength as a nation. And it is not the main reason why we lead the free world. And if you think that that is, then you're going down the path of past countries that have tried to lead with just military strength and failed, whether it was World War II Germany or the Soviet Union or other places. You have to stand on your values, and you have to stand on who you are as a people, and you have to engage, and that comes from diplomatic efforts. And our military leaders will tell you the same thing. The military's job is to come in and blow shit up. It's not to nation build, it's not to engage. So let's not try to use the military for that. We'll use them when we need to, and they'll be happy to come in and do their jobs because they're professionals. But then when that happens, let's nation build. Let's work with our allies. And let's maybe do it so that we don't have to send our military men and women to go die on foreign soil.
Well said. So Maggie mentioned a few ways in her opening remarks about how you've been quite the trailblazer in the course of your career. So what advice do you have for young women, especially women of color, that are hoping to pursue a career in public service, perhaps along similar lines as you have?
Yeah, get out of your own way. Get out of your own head and get out of your own way. And that really is a lot of what happens. I no one is more surprised than me every morning to realize the job that I have. And the imposter syndrome is very real. I sit down to lunch, so it's usually every Tuesday is the Democratic Caucus. We all sit down together and we discuss the issues and the like. But I sit down to lunch with my colleagues, and half of them are running for president. and I'm like, you know, and it you know, I sit down with some of the great minds and I'm like, how am I even here? I'm just a broken down old helicopter pilot. How am I here? And not even a good pilot, because I flew into a RPG. I couldn't even I didn't even do a good job.
I think you probably flew into you. But semantics.
I'm actually quoting John McCain. When I met Senator McCain, I was actually a patient at Walter Reed, and when I was first wounded, and McCain sat down with me, and the nurses and everybody was like gushing, like, Senator McCain, this is Captain Duckworth. She was shot down too. You guys have so much in common. You're both heroes. And McCain just looked at me and was like, didn't take a lot of talent to fly into a missile. What else are you going to do? I loved him. But what I say is get out of your own way and don't stop yourself from going into those non-traditional roles. When I was in flight school, I was the only female in my particular class, and the instructors would come up to me all the time, like, do you have any other women that you know that would apply to military flight school to become helicopter pilots? Because women make better natural pilots than men on day one. It has to do with multitasking ability. If you get a guy and you tell him to like take that bridge or take that out that machine gun's nest, he's like laser focused, he's gonna do that. But if you need someone who can fly the aircraft that takes both hands, both feet, listen to three different radio channels, read the map, talk to your crew in the backseat, talk to the aircraft over there, and make sure you don't get lost, you want a woman.
No disagreement.
Yeah, so they found, so we're always trying to get more women to apply, but the women never apply. No one was preventing the women from applying. They just never apply because they never thought of themselves as being pilots. And I think that's what happens a lot among women and minority candidates, is that you see certain images of what this person is, and you don't see your face in that position, or someone who looks like you in that position, so then you don't go after it because you don't think of that as a possibility. And we have to break those barriers, but then we have to be able to image that. And so that's what I say to folks is, you know, just try it. And if you fail, so what? Get back up and try it again. Try to be that ambassador. There's no reason that an ambassador needs to be a white man. An ambassador can be anyone, and in fact, some of the best ambassadors we have are the ones who have the cultural backgrounds for the countries that they're going to represent.
I love that. And we actually had an audience question about imposter syndrome, but I think that you just answered it, so it's clearly something that they wanted to hear about as well. So thank you for touching
on that. Yeah, fake it till you make it, but you know, show up. I mean, have all the imposter syndrome you need to go through, but then show up. Show up. And that's half of the fight right there, just showing up.
Absolutely. So that was Claire Midas from the Elliott School. You had your question answered. I don't know if you're in the audience, but so to pivot to some of these other audience questions, so it's a little bit of a grab bag of whatever came in. But we have a question here from Elliott School student James Davis. So he, in typical DC fashion, before his question, there's a bit of a comment, so just bear with me.
My colleague Dick Durbin always says when we do a constituent coffee is that you better ask, there may be the question mark at the end of whatever you say, because if you're gonna give a speech and you need to run for office, then you can give a speech.
Right, just an upward inflection at the end of the statement, right, that's the question. So James writes, as Hong Kongers, a word I learned today, as Hong Kongers struggle for their continued autonomy, the threat of China looms larger than ever as a threat to the security of America and our democratic allies. To combat this, President Obama proposed the Trans-Pacific Partnership, which could have hurt American workers. And now President Trump has embarked on a disastrous trade war. How do we unite our allies across East Asia in the face of Chinese authoritarianism without hurting our workers and farmers?
Well, we need to show up. And I'm dealing with this issue right now because I'm really focusing on the Asia Pacific region, and I've been doing a lot of trips to the Asia Pacific region and meeting with leaders. And what they say time and again is that they just need a U.S. presence. That we cannot leave their area to China. Excuse me, I have a bad cold. My daughter brings home every cold and flu from pre-K.
Well, very cute germ factories, right?
Oh my gosh, the petri dishes. My whole family is down with the cold. So we have to be present, we have to engage. And that means everything from the U.S. showing up and sending ships to navigable waters to ensure freedom of navigation in the Asia Pacific region to us really engaging in the economy of the region, which means that we have to engage in trade. We have to make the best trade deal possible, but we have to engage in trade, because if we don't, the Chinese will come in and with their tactics and they are persistent. They will stay and they will keep working at it, and they have the resources and the entire state behind them. And so we cannot leave the playing field to the Chinese. And that's the first thing that they say. You don't need to come here and be, you know, the biggest and the baddest at any of the things, but you have to remain engaged. So they said with the Chinese, with the Belt and Road Initiative and some of the things that they're doing, the TPP was what these countries were looking for as a way to counter China. And by abandoning the TPP, we actually left them with many of these countries with no other option other than China. Now that said, I have problems with the TPP, especially with the labor environmental issues, and I'm having problems with MCA, the new NAFTA that's being negotiated. I think we can do better to make sure that we put in environmental and labor protections. The way the document reads right now is it provides those protections in the U.S., but it's not required them in Mexico. It only says you should, not you shall language, and the language should be changed to you shall. And we should do that same thing when we renegotiate a TPP or something. But we have to engage. We cannot isolate ourselves.
Great point. And this is from Elliott School student Benjamin Halstead. He says, what solutions do we need to put in place to help calm down the situation between India and Pakistan? So if you could solve that for us in like 30 seconds, that would be great.
I mean, you know, right now we don't have much standing in the world diplomatically to do anything, and that's part of the problem, right? We have burned through any type of credibility that we had on the international arena, and now with this abandonment of the Kurds and what has happened in Iraq, we have diminished ourselves even lower than I thought we could have gone. And so at this point, I don't know what we can do with India and Pakistan, because I don't think they're going to listen to us.
Fair. So another question from an unnamed Colombian college student who says, can you please share an anecdote with us about a time that you expected your career to go in one direction and it ended up going in another? And what did you learn from these shifts or changes in your goals?
Well, how I became a politician. Even after I was wounded and I was at Walter Reed, I was working for Rotary International, helping provide services to Rotary clubs in the Asia Pacific region. So it was kind of an international Rotary, you know, the Rotary clubs like the Kiwanis or their service organizations. But Rotary clubs all around the world have to do service projects every year. And my last thing I was doing at Rotary was actually helping Rotarians send wheelchairs into Iraq. And helping Rotarians access cheap and affordable prosthetics in India for war victims in the Middle East. Somewhat ironic. And then I found myself serving in Iraq as a pilot. I thought I was going back to that job because Rotary is a great, great organization, and they were welcoming me back. And then I got pissed off at Walter Reed because we weren't taking care of our military men and women there the way we should. We had the best health care there. Let me make that clear. I had the best health care I possibly had. But the Bush administration did not expect the Iraq war to last more than 2 weeks. And so they never put in the administrative apparatus to take care of how many wounded continue to come out and how severe we wounded were. So I'll give you an example. They never provided housing for family members. So you had people like me who were in the ICU and family members literally sleeping on the intensive care unit's waiting room floor for weeks at a time because there was no housing provided for family members. We had people who did not receive pay because they were at Walter Reed, and so then their families went without pay. So people were, there was just all sorts of administrative stuff. And so I started calling my two U.S. senators whom I'd met at the hospital, Dick Durbin and newly elected Barack Obama, that nobody knew who he was, the guy with the funny name. And Dick Durbin gave me his cell phone number on the back of his business card, which is a lesson I learned, never do. Because I used that phone number and I called him up, and within months, Dick Durbin became the unofficial ombudsman for Walter Reed. And Barack Obama happened to be on the Veterans Affairs Committee because he was his new senator, and they gave him the crappiest committee assignment because nobody wanted to be on the Veterans Affairs Committee at the time. And so he started calling me to testify, and after about 10 months, Dick Durbin called me up and said, "You need to run for Congress." And I was like, "You know that I'm in the hospital, right?" I'm like, "No, I'm going back home." He's like, "No. Obviously, we're not taking care of veterans, and you need to think about running." And this goes back to your earlier question about women and minorities. We don't see ourselves in these positions. And Emily's List did a study that shows that women have to be asked 7 times to run for office before they finally say yes, whereas most of the men who run for office self-initiate.
Did you bring that average down by just the one request?
The one, yeah, I did. So my husband and I, you know, sat and talked about it, and he's like, "This was a." He got me at a point where I needed to serve my country, and I just realized I wasn't going to do it flying helicopters again, and this was my new mission, and I had gotten to a point where prior to being wounded, I don't think I would have said yes because I would have been afraid of failure. After being wounded, my attitude was kind of like, what's the worst going to happen? Blow me up? Been there, done that, still here. So I said yes, and that's how I ended up in politics. But it is not an unusual story for women in politics. If you read the bios, most of the women who are elected into the House or the Senate did not start out wanting to be a career politician. A lot of the men, you'll find out they were, their father were elected to office, or they were a Senate page, or they were a staffer, or they went to law school because they wanted to run for office, and they have a very clear career path. But if you talk to the women, you'll find people like Jan Schakowsky from Illinois, who was a mom who was in the 70s trying to buy bread and milk for her family, but the milk and bread was, she didn't know when the milk and bread had been, how old it was, and so she'd buy bread and it'd go stale quickly because there were no sell-by dates then. So then she, from a kitchen table, organized the first campaign to put sell-by dates on food. And as a result of that, that led to her running for office. Or you have, you know, all you talk to the women, and they're all of these stories over and over again. I didn't mean to do this. I was doing something else, and I got thrust into this. So that's my anecdote. But it's the same anecdote with a lot of the women who are in office now. They'll tell you similar stories. I was a high school principal, and I got really mad about educational policy, and you know, they pushed me to run, and nobody was running, and so I did, and I won, and here I am.
It's a happy little accident.
Yeah, well, but this is what I said about, you know, a lot of women and people of color. They don't put themselves in that role.
Right, absolutely. So actually, speaking of women in the Senate and in Congress in general, Elliott School student Zoe Garbus had a question. She wrote, "In light of your changes to the Senate regarding bringing children and making it a family-friendly space, how do you foresee your workplace changing in the future regarding its accessibility to mothers?"
We have a lot more work to do. We now have changing tables in the senator's bathroom. Yay! we don't have nursing rooms yet, so we can work on that. No, I think that we can do better. First and foremost, we just need to pass universal family leave, paid family leave. It just needs to be a national thing. And we can do this in a lot of different ways that doesn't cost taxpayers a lot of money. So I am co-sponsoring the Family Act with Kirsten Gillibrand that would actually set up an insurance plan. And the way it would work would be employers would pay $2 a week, and the employee would pay in $2 a week into this insurance plan that would actually give you paid time off, 12 weeks, if you need to use it. And when you talk to employers and say, hey, would you be willing to pay $2 a week per employee? And they're, you know, it's you know, we're talking about a little over $100 a year to make sure your employees could have paid leave. They're like, yeah, that's nothing. I spend more from absenteeism when employees have to take unpaid time off to go take care of their family members. I would rather do this. So we can do this. We're the only developed nation in the world that does not have paid family leave. And we just need to pass that first and foremost. If we pass that, that'll have and affect the Senate. But right now, federal employees don't have a universal leave policy, and it depends on the department. Some have a generous 6-week paid leave policy for the birth of a child. That's not generous. That's inadequate. And each senator can set their own, which is not acceptable.
No, I did not know that.
Every Senate office can, and every House of Representative member can set their own leave policies.
No, that must be nice.
Well, but there's a problem, right? If you have people working for you that, you know, you could work in one Senate office, and if you work in mine, you get 16 weeks paid. If you work in another, you may not only get 2. Or whatever that is, that's, people deserve better than that.
Yeah, absolutely. And so we've actually run through all the questions that came from the audience, but I wanted to give you the opportunity, if there was a question that I or the audience didn't ask you, that you'd like to take this opportunity to kind of just speak to the audience that you have here about, and the live stream audience as well, what would you like to say to them? The floor is yours.
Yeah, well, I think that we need to increase participation in national service in this country, and I think this audience in particular, most of you are choosing especially the sorority, to talk about national service. And we can't always just define national service as military service. We are at a point in our nation's history where we don't teach civics classes anymore, and we have an all-volunteer military, so there's no draft, so that you have fewer and fewer people performing national service, and you have more and more people who are disconnected to really the ideals of this country, because there is no mandatory service. And I'm fine with an all-volunteer force. In fact, I don't support a draft. But I do think that we need to raise the prestige of national service, and we need to find a way to allow folks to perform national service. So I've introduced legislation that would make national service available to all young people in this country. My philosophy is, if I got 4 years of college education through the GI Bill for picking up a rifle, you should be able to get 4 years of college education for picking up a soup ladle, a hammer, a piece of chalk. And we could create a program, and the programs already exist, there's just not enough seats in them, to expand Teach for America, AmeriCorps, all of these programs, so that you would be able to, say, do an 18 months at one of these programs and earn 2 years of college tuition. And then you could go back and do another 18 months and earn another 2 years. And that would allow every young person in America to earn what is debt-free college. It's not free college because you're going to work for it, but it would be debt-free college. At the same time, you have a chance to serve your country and see more of this country and give something back. Because we take a lot for granted in this country, and it seems to be the same families over and over again, especially in the military, who serve and who sacrifice. And a lot of families who never do a darn thing. And that's fine, that's their right to do that, but I think we would be a stronger nation if more of us served.
I think that's a wonderful vision, and I hope it becomes reality someday. I'm getting the wrap-up signal, so I think we're officially done now. But I did want to thank everyone who attended today here in person, but also our audience who watched the live stream. Thank you also to Delta Phi Epsilon Professional Foreign Service Sorority and the Elliott School for facilitating this event. And last but certainly not least, thank you to Senator Duckworth for sharing both her time and her insights with us this evening.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, everybody.